Hi everyone, and welcome to this tutorial bite for Oxygen Not Included, where we're looking at geothermal power. This means using the magma that is either found naturally on the map or produced by volcanoes to make power. I'll look at designs for these and some ways of controlling the heat flow in. All geothermal power is based around the steam turbine. These sit on top of a steam room and take in steam from below. Then they output this steam as 95 degree water, deleting the heat and making power. A cooling loop is needed to cool the turbines, as they generate a lot of heat and won't work above 100 degrees Celsius. This setup as shown is exactly the same as a typical cooling loop. If you are not familiar with this method of cooling, then please see the cooling tutorial bite first. For geothermal power, we need to heat the steam room with magma. Magma is commonly found around the map, most typically at the bottom of a map as a molten core, but it can also spawn in pockets higher up, for example with the magma channel world trait. In the spaced out DLC, if you are playing the moonlit cluster scenario, then you will encounter the flipped planetoid, which has a large layer of magma just below the surface. All magma found naturally occurring is a finite resource, so when used for power, it will eventually run out, although this could take thousands of cycles. The other source of magma is volcanoes that come in a normal and minor variant. I covered these in the tutorial bite on geysers, but we'll recap the key points here. They both produce magma over 1700 degrees Celsius, which will solidify into igneous rock when cooled. Minor volcanoes simply produce less magma than normal volcanoes. Atmosuits are required to deal with magma, not just because of the temperatures, but mainly because of the need to maintain vacuum rooms. Tiles of vacuum transfer no heat, so are the best way to contain a volcano to store magma, in addition to insulated tiles made of obsidian, which will never melt. This applies to both capturing volcanoes and managing natural magma. With both of these magma sources, an important point is its location. I'm going to cover three methods, with the first being dropping magma to make debris. This will obviously only work if you can build the steam room below the magma source, so does not work well with pools at the bottom of the map. But before looking at the steam room design, I need to cover the magma blade. I also covered this in the tutorial bite for petroleum boilers. A magma blade is a community name given to this design of 10 tiles that carefully controls magma flow. This is because magma is very viscous, so passing it through a one tile gap will make a blade exactly 10 tiles long. With the magma blade, we can now control the final tile with a mechanized airlock, made of steel so it doesn't melt. This is controlled by a thermosensor set to below 195 degrees Celsius. I'm also using here a memory toggle with a filter and buffer gate. These work together to make sure only a small amount of magma is dropped in each time, especially when starting this up. For settings, the filter gate is set to 4 seconds and the buffer to 15 seconds. When the door opens, the magma starts dripping slowly into the mesh tiles below. It rests on the bottom tile before quickly turning into igneous rock debris as the heat is transferred with a diamond temp shift plate. As it turns into debris, it's pushed out of the mesh tile, and this is where we use this behaviour to our advantage. When forming debris, it needs to go somewhere. The game will check each surrounding tile in turn, starting with the tile above, then going clockwise. Because there are two mesh tiles, the only way the debris can escape is diagonally into the steam room. By doing this diagonally, the magma and steam areas are kept separate. Once into the steam room, the debris will immediately heat the area around it, providing heat to the turbines to make power. The cooling loop is needed here, as I mentioned earlier, to cool the turbines. This is a standard cooling loop, as I explained in the cooling tutorial bite, so I won't repeat that here. I've set the thermopipe sensor to above 35 degrees Celsius, but any temperature under 100 degrees will be fine to keep the turbines working. To control the turbines, you can disable them with a smart battery, much like any generator, as I explained in the tutorial bite for power generation. If you do choose to do this, you can avoid wasting heat, but ensure that the steam turbine near the aquatuner is always enabled. If this turbine is shut off, then there is a high chance that the aquatuner will overheat. For sizing, you can use as many turbines as you like, but the amount you can run sustainably from a volcano depends on the calculated average output. From doing the maths with the heat output, an average volcano can run 2 turbines and a minor volcano only 1. This will vary slightly in practice. Bear this in mind if you want to run them constantly, but you could use more if you automate the turbines to only turn on when needed. For each turbine you have, the net power output is around 650 watts, once cooling is taken into account. So an average volcano will only generate about 1.3 kilowatts, and a minor volcano only about 650 watts constantly. Overall, it should be said that a petroleum boiler will generate more power and extra resources if you have access to the oil, so are really a better use for volcanoes on balance. I explain these more advanced builds in their own tutorial bite, linked in the card. Now back to this specific design. It is good, but the rock stays in the steam chamber and remains hot. So as an improvement, you can use solid shipping rails to distribute the heat and recover the rock out. I explain solid shipping in more detail in its own tutorial bite. Note that both the auto sweeper and conveyor loader are made of steel to not overheat, but I have placed these away from the magma area as well. The rock loops around until it reaches below 200 degrees Celsius. Then a conveyor shutoff brings the rock out, linked to a conveyor rail thermosensor. In this design, the rock is collected as waste as it's still quite hot. This can already be used for building in atmosuit accessed areas, but without them will scald dupes and is also too hot for hatches. There is usually so much rock diggable on the map anyway that cooling it is generally unnecessary, but it is technically possible. To recover it, run the outgoing rail against a cooling loop behind some tiles. Beware though that cooling the rock to 60 degrees Celsius would need 2 thermo aquatuners with a polluted water coolant, which would consume a significant amount of the power generated from this design. To build the design, ensure the magma room is vacuumed and liquid locked if you want dupe access, as I showed earlier. The steam room can be filled with 2 layers of normal and salt water. Around 100 kg per tile is a good target. Beware not to use polluted water, as the dirt produced may turn into natural sand tiles. This will take some time to evaporate all the water, but will soon be completely steam and work normally. Having covered everything, here is the one take reference for this design. So the second design to share is the heat injector and heat spike. This approach is more flexible, but a little less efficient at using magma. The heat injector here is 2 layers of diamond window tiles with a steel mechanized airlock in the middle. When the temperature is above 200 degrees Celsius, the door opens, stopping the heat transfer. 200 degrees is the lowest and most efficient temperature for a steam turbine to output maximum power. When the door closes, it simply pulls heat from the magma next to the steam room, meaning it can be from below. The steam room and cooling is otherwise similar to the last design. As power is made, the magma will slowly lose heat and solidify into igneous rock. Once it becomes too cold to keep powering the turbines, we need to get into hotter areas. Using a liquid lock and vacuum, we can dig out the colder rock and build in more diamond window tiles to conduct the heat back up. There are a few ways of doing this, for example with temp shift plates, but window tiles work well. This kind of build is commonly referred to as a heat spike, as it grows into a spike to pull in the heat. Note that this method will also leave quite a lot of heat in the rock. It would also be possible to recover more by loading it onto a conveyor rail like the last build, but beware that if dupes try and carry the very hot rock through the liquid lock, it will likely heat up and become a gas. Then, large amounts of heat will be transferred, so be very cautious trying to use or recover the rock. For naturally forming magma, the source will eventually run out, but this will typically take hundreds, if not thousands of cycles, depending on how many turbines are used. This is also a useful way of clearing magma areas by turning it into igneous rock debris. Now, having gone through those methods, I wanted to quickly touch on the third, pumping magma. I will cover how to get the magma into the pipe in the tutorial bite for moving materials. The magma flows through the radiant pipes at 1 kg per second, stopping it from solidifying. It gives its heat to the steam as it passes, coming out of the liquid vent as cool igneous rock. The rest of this design is very similar to the first. And that's everything for this look at geothermal power. I hope this gives you another option for making power and dealing with magma, and thanks for watching.